right now. And while we're going through this coronavirus, this COVID-19 thing, it's good to remember that resurrection speaks of new beginnings, the old going away and the new coming in, and so many different things. And I love it because our Lord and Savior rose from the grave. We can also come out of those hard situations in our life when we accept Him as Savior. He's our healer and our deliverer and everything else. We look to Him for everything. And so I'm excited about it. And if you got your Bibles there, turn, if you will, to John, the 19th chapter. I'm not going to read everything in the Easter story, but the pertinent things to the message this morning. So in John 19, in the New Living Translation, it said, then Pilate had Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip. The soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put a purple robe on him. Hail, King of Jews, they mocked as they slapped him across the face. Pilate went outside and said to the people, I'm going to bring him out to you now, but understand clearly that I find him not guilty. Then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said, look, here is the man. Then they saw him. The leading priests and temple guards began shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Take him yourselves and crucify him, Pilate said. I find him not guilty. The Jewish leaders replied, by our law, he ought to die because he called himself the Son of God. When Pilate heard this, he was more frightened than ever. He took Jesus back into the headquarters again and asked him, where are you from? But Jesus gave no answer. Why don't you talk to me? Pilate demanded. Don't you realize that I have the power to release you or crucify you? Then Jesus said, you would have no power over me at all unless it were given to you from above. So the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin. Then Pilate tried to release him, but the Jewish leaders shouted, if you release this man, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who declares himself a king is a rebel against Caesar. When they said this, Pilate brought Jesus out to them again. Then Pilate sat down on the judgment seat on the platform that is called the Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. And it was now about noon on the day of preparation for the Passover. And Pilate said to the people, look, here is your king. Away with him, they yelled. Away with him. Crucify him. What? Crucify your king, Pilate said. We have no king but Caesar. The leading priest shouted back. Then Pilate turned Jesus over to them to be crucified.
Drive the nails in my hands, let it be wasted. Go ahead, say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see, 'cause I'm no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead, mark my name. my love for you will be the same. Go ahead and bury me, very soon I will be free, 'cause I'll rise again. Ain't no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. 'Cause death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead, say I'm dead and gone, but you will see that you were wrong. Go ahead, try to hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one, 'cause I'll come. Ain't no power on earth can keep me back. Yes, I'll come again. Come and take my people back.
So they took Jesus away. Carrying the cross by himself, he went to the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they nailed him to the cross. Two others were crucified with him on one side, and Jesus between them. And Pilate posted a sign on the cross that said, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek, so many people could read it. Then the leading priests objected and said to Pilate, "Change it from King of the Jews to He said, I am King of the Jews." And Pilate replied, "No, what I've written, I've written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they divided his clothes among the four of them. They also took his robe, and it was seamless, went in one place from top to bottom. So they said, "Rather than tearing it apart, let's throw dice for it." This fulfilled the scripture that said, "They divided my garments among them and threw dice for my clothing." So that is what they did. Standing near the cross were Jesus' mother and his mother's sister. I don't have light now. When Jesus saw his mother standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to this disciple, "Here is your mother." Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill scripture, he said, "I am thirsty." The jar of sour wine was sitting there, so they soaked a sponge in it to put a hyssop branch and held it to his lips. When Jesus had tasted it, he said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. And I'm going to move over to the 20th chapter. Early on Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciples whom Jesus loved. She said, "They've taken the Lord's body out of the tomb. We don't know where they put him."
Mm-hmm.
Mary came into the tomb of Jesus. The stone had moved and he had gone away. The angel said, "Fear not, I know whom seek ye. But he's risen." And then she heard him say, "Gone, the stone is rolled back, gone, the tomb is empty, gone, to sit at the Father's side. Gone, over death triumphant, gone, sin is defeated, gone, and he lives forevermore. My friend, if you don't know my risen Savior, I beg of you, don't wait too late to pray. Don't wait until his bride has been completed. Don't wait until you hear him say it's too late. Gone, the stone is rolled back, gone, the tomb is empty, gone, to sit at the Father's side. I know he's gone, over death triumphant, gone, sin is defeated, gone, and he lives forevermore. Gone, the stone is rolled back, gone, the tomb is empty, gone, to sit at the Father's side. But I know he's gone, over death triumphant, gone, sin is defeated, gone, and he lives forevermore, and he lives forevermore.
In verse 11 in the 20th chapter, it said, Mary was standing outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she stooped and looked in. She saw two white-robed angels, one sitting at the head and the other at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" the angels asked her. "Because they've taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they put him." And she turned to leave and saw someone standing there. And it was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked her. "Who are you looking for?" She thought he was the gardener. "Sir, if you've taken him away, tell me where you put him, and I'll go and get him." And I believe this is how Jesus said it. I don't think he yelled a bit. I think he said it just as loving as he always talked to Mary. And I think he just said, "Mary." She turned to him and cried out, "Rabboni," which is Hebrew for teacher. "Don't cling to me," Jesus said, "for I haven't yet ascended to the Father. But go find my brothers and tell them I'm ascending to the Father and your Father and to my God and your God." And Mary Magdalene found the disciples and told them I've seen the Lord. Then she gave him his message. Man, I tell you what, I haven't sung in a long time. We've been locked up inside of our house, and the only singing I've done is to Debbie. And I've been doing that for 38 years, so she wasn't impressed. But I want to tell you something. The first Easter Sunday, and I think I put this on Facebook, people said, how can we celebrate Easter if we can't get to the church? And I told them, I said, the first Easter just had a few people around and an empty tomb. We celebrate Easter because Easter is celebrating the resurrection of our Lord. You know, one of the things that made Easter Sunday, the first one, so tremendous, wasn't just the resurrection, but because before, that day had been horrible. Good Friday commemorates the crucifixion, and Easter Sunday, the resurrection. But the Saturday in between really commemorates a time of desperation. The spear had sliced his heart and his tongue had gone silent. Death was absolute. No one was betting on his resurrection. And yet, we'll see how you can get unstuck from horrible Saturdays into resurrection Sundays. Saturday was a no hope, no courage day. While Jesus' opponents celebrated his death, his disciples were hiding in fear that they too would receive a cross. The disciples had been behind closed doors in fear. The disciples did not trust Jesus' promises of resurrection. Mark 8:21 in the New King James Version says, so he said to them, how is it you don't understand? And in Mark 9:31, he said, for he taught his disciples and said to them, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and after he's killed, he will rise the third day. That was pretty clear, wasn't it? And Mark 10:24 says that the disciples were astonished at his words, but Jesus answered again and said to them, children, how hard is it for those who trust in riches to enter the kingdom of God? Man, the women disciples, they did not intend to celebrate Jesus' resurrection body, but to embalm that body. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they could embalm him. But what did they find when they went to that tomb? They found an empty tomb. You know, we can get stuck on this side. Let me talk about, I'm so sick and tired hearing about COVID-19. But I want to tell you, for a lot of people, COVID-19 is like the Saturday between the crucifixion and the resurrection. And can I tell you, because of our resurrected Lord, you're going to turn around one of these days and all of this stuff, nonsense will be gone, and we're back to living life the way we intended. Everyone dies. We try to avoid that reality. We brush our teeth, eat good foods, pay our bills, or we're supposed to eat good foods. Romeo and Juliet died. John F. Kennedy died. Princess Diana died. Everybody dies. Whether you're a famous person or a little old pastor from Buckner, everyone dies. Love gets buried in a tomb. Man. Max Lucado tells the story of his brother D. D was an outgoing, friend-making, joy-bringing kind of guy. D was a personal ambassador for his shy younger brother, Max. In his teen years, D met a bootlegger and alcohol-trapped. For four decades, D drank away his health, his friends, his jobs, and his money. At age 54, D made a serious decision to join AA. His life and marriage stabilized, but the years of alcohol and smoking three packs a day left D in very fragile health. He began to have chest pains. He was rushed to the emergency room by the ambulance. By the time his wife, Donna, arrived with one of their sons, D was gone. They went in to see his dead body. One of his hands was resting on his thigh with his fingers curled in the international sign language form of I love you. And Max knows why D did that. He had moved out of Saturday and into Sunday. when we use loved ones, we always got to remember that they have moved out of their Saturday experience and moved into the Sunday experience of being present with the Lord. Amen? Sunday, Resurrection Day. It's a day of eternal love, life, and hope. And I want you to remember this, that no matter how bad it seems out there, God is still God. God is still seated on his throne. I had a guy get a hold of me on Facebook, wanted to argue about Scripture. So finally, I just told him, I said, well, let's just agree to disagree. I don't care what people think. We know what the truth is. Amen? Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples she'd seen the Lord and that he'd spoken those things. The empty tomb did not take away her despair and grief. The angels did not take away her despair and grief. Mary Magdalene, the one Jesus befriended and delivered from demonic oppression, had the sadness of Saturday covering her heart. But Jesus is alive from the dead, and he knows how to restore the brokenhearted. Jesus speaks Mary's name, and she realizes that Jesus, her Lord, is alive from the dead. I'm going to turn to another scripture, Romans 1, 1 through 7 in the New King James. It says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection of the dead. The resurrection of the dead, when Jesus was resurrected, you know what he was saying? I'm he. I'm Jesus. I'm the Messiah. I'm the deliverer. I'm the healer. I'm the Savior. Why did Jesus personally appear to Mary Magdalene? Because that's just the kind of person Jesus is. I want to tell you today that God cares about you personally. You might be in darkness now, but there is light coming. Things may look dark all around you, but don't focus on the dark. Focus on the light. Realize that we have a risen Savior. He's here to take away your heartaches and your troubles and give you peace and light at this time. I'm going to share a scripture that I use at funerals lots of times, but I'm going to share it with you right now. 1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 20. Tell me this, in the New Living Translation. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? People still say things like that. When you go to that grave, that's it. Well, I said, that'd be cold, lonely, and wormy. I don't care about that. But if there is no resurrection of the dead, I want you to hear how Paul says this. But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless, and your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless, and you're still guilty of all your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, then we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He's the first of a great harvest of all who died. Man, let's look at those things. Let's look at those six things. In verse 14, if Christ had not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. But listen, but since Christ has been raised, our preaching is not in vain. Verse 14 also says, and your faith is in vain. But since Christ has been raised, our faith is not in vain. You can place your faith in this Almighty God because you know that Jesus has proved who he is. You know in your heart, no matter what the world says, and place your faith in him. Verse 15, if Christ has not been raised, we're found to be misrepresenting God. But since Christ has been raised, the apostles are not false witnesses about the work of God. I will preach about the resurrection until the day that this spirit leaves this body. I know it to be true and have experienced it in my life. In verse 17, if Christ had not been raised, then your faith is futile and you're still in your sins. But folks, listen to me. Because Christ has been raised, we've been cleansed of all our sin. When I stand before the Lord's not going to say, what about this, what about this, what about this? Listen, when I stand before the Lord, I will stand as pure, as clean as Jesus himself, because Jesus took all my sin and I got his righteousness. Oh, aren't you glad about that? Right now you ought to be saying amen, sitting in your living rooms right now. In verse 18, if Christ had not been raised, then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have truly perished. But since Christ has been raised, the dead in Christ have not really perished. Your loved ones, that body is in that grave. But understand this, that their spirit went on to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. And someday at the rapture, the Lord will come back, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who remain will be caught up together with them forever to be with the Lord. And it said, comfort one another with these words. And verse 19 said, Christ has not been raised. Then we're of all men most to be pitied. But since Christ has been raised, we are not to be pitied. We're to be envied. Man, the resurrection is connected for our forgiveness. If Jesus had been stayed in that grave, then he's no different than anybody else. But because he came out of that grave, he overcame sin, sickness, poverty, all the things that plague us today. Romans 4:25 puts it like this. He was handed over to death on account of our transgressions, and he was raised on account of our justification. Are you glad about that today? Our faith is well-founded. We can stand upon the Word of God. What we preach is true. It's proven by the resurrection. We are to be envied by the rest of the world, not pitied by the rest of the world. He is alive, and he is well, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and someday I'm going to see him, and you're going to see him. 2 Corinthians 4:17, remember this. This will really apply to you right now. This slight momentary affliction is working for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. And so we're told the word, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. And all of you that have lost people, understand you haven't really lost them. They may have died and their body went in that grave, but Jesus was the first fruits of the resurrection, and they're going to resurrect from that grave someday. It's the greatest news that's ever hit this world. The resurrection of Jesus Christ. He gave us forgiveness. He gave us a friend that stands closer than a brother. He gave us guidance and continues to guide us. He gave us a life that is not to be pitied, but to be envied. And he gave us everlasting joy. Everlasting joy. Happiness can be a short period of thing. But the joy that you have in your heart, nothing can steal it. Therefore, I'm urging you this morning to lift up your heart and say with the choirs on earth, worthy is the Lamb that was slain and hath redeemed us to God by his blood to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength in honor and glory and blessing. Are you glad about that today? Amen. Spend some time with your family. Fellowship. Thank God for all the many blessings we have. And we'll be online to see you after this. I love you more than peanut butter. Thanks, heart of God. Oh, you're going to do your announcements? My wife, my honey baby sugar doll, is going to come up and make announcements. Yes, speak into it.
Hello.
And speak up.
Hello, Heart of God. It's so good to see all of you. I had somebody text me and say, can you please show your face? So here's my face. And I'm going to make some announcements. Harvesters is happening tomorrow. It will be a drive-through Harvesters. The gates will not open until 4 o'clock. So do not show up here early. You cannot come in the building. You will not be getting out of your car. It will just, you'll just drive through and they'll put food in your car. If you're a worker for Harvesters, contact Stephen Gray to find out what the plan is for that. Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, we will do a virtual class on Christ the Healer. You can get on Facebook, the Heart of God website, or Facebook to find out the link to that, or call the pastor, or you can talk to Melissa about that also to get the link to get on to do that class with us. Thursday night, Silas will be preaching the Thursday night service, virtually, of course. So get on and listen to him. Anyway, I think that's all I've got. If you want to give your tithes, you can do that on the Heart of God website. And we just want to say thank you for being so faithful and for your giving through this time. And we're looking forward to being able to see all of you in person here at the church again, hopefully very soon. We love you all, and thank you for all that you do out there while you're, whatever you're doing. Thank you for the people that are in, working and trying to keep us all safe, and stay safe, and we love you all.